You're listening to the Dean Martin Association podcast, the place for all things Dino. In this episode, Elliot is joined by and chats with Mark Halliday about the importance of Dean Martin's legacy in today's world. Welcome to episode 10.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm all right. Thank you very much. How's it going? It's been a while since I've seen you.
It has. It has indeed. You've been very, very busy. West End schedules.
it's been a bit crazy lately, which is a good thing.
Return to me, oh my dear, I'm so lonely. Hurry back, oh my love, hurry back, I am yours. Return to me, for my heart wants you only. Hurry home, won't you please hurry home to my heart. My darling, if I hurt you, I'm sorry. Forgive me, and please say you are mine. Return to me. Please come back, Bella Mia. Hurry back, hurry home to my arms, to my lips and my heart. Ritorna me, cara mia.
Well, Mark, thank you for joining us. Absolute pleasure to speak to you. And your history with Dean goes back now nearly 20 years.
It does. Wow. Yes. Isn't that wild?
How did you get to that point? How did you get to Dean?
How did I get to Dean? So originally I was a performer, a musical theatre performer, performed in things like, you know, Greece, Aspects of Love, that sort of thing. And when I was 28, I was offered an audition for the Rat Pack show. And to be perfectly honest, I didn't really know a lot about them at all. I'd heard of Frank Sinatra, I've heard of Dean Martin, but I didn't really have any idea of how powerful their music was or anything like that. And so when I was offered the audition, so the standard practice when you're offered an audition is you do a little bit of homework into the character, if it's a real life character, have a listen to the music, have a listen to the sound. And that was at the point when I started to get really interested in the project, because I thought, this music is incredible. This guy's voice is incredible. And he has so much fun. And it's like nothing I've ever seen before. So I really wanted the job. Yeah, I really want it. And thankfully, I got it. And that was, as you say, 19 years ago now.
Yeah.
And then from that point, it took me all over the world. You know, we worked in we did a European tour. We did the American tour. We worked in the West End show. And so it's been an incredible part of my life for the last 20 years.
Yeah. So, but you don't play Dean anymore, do you? Have you handed that over to somebody else? Is that correct?
That's correct. Having said that, I am jumping in next weekend to cover a gig. So, okay. For one of our long-term clients, we have an arrangement that if my usual guy isn't available, I will still jump in and dust off the old syrup and get in and do a bit of deaning. Yeah, but generally speaking, I am behind the scenes now trying to run the show.
Yeah. And for you, does that give you more, because it's your own company, isn't it, Veritas, that now does
that? Correct. Yeah.
Does that give you more control about who you want and you control the show better?
Absolutely.
I guess you were with Flying Music, weren't you, in 2004?
Yes, I was. Yeah. With Flying Music Show.
So coming out of that and becoming Veritas, did you find naturally that you're able to put in what you wanted people to see of Dean?
Absolutely. I think that obviously Flying Music put together a great show, a great product. Everybody regards it as the original Rat Pack tribute, and as it should be, because what they did was, I think that the Rat Pack show, the Flying Music West End show, changed the meaning of the word tribute in modern society. Yeah. So as we all know, in every theatre in the country for the last 15 years, you will see some top class tributes to every artist that ever existed. Yeah. And allegedly, and I can't remember where I saw this statistic, so don't hold me to it, but I was told that it's a £300 million a year industry within the entertainment sector, the tributes market. Yeah. And I can believe it. But sounds I think that the West End Rat Pack show has changed the face of the word tribute for modern entertainment. Before that, it was generally regarded a little bit tongue-in-cheek, as if you think of tribute, you think of a dodgy Elvis down the pub.
I've used the same analogy,
No disrespect to Elvis's, there's some incredible ones out there, some good friends of mine. But that's how you originally think of tribute. Yeah. But that show, the delivery of it, the attention to detail, not only in the music, but in the performers and the performances, it changed the way people saw tribute. So I think the whole tributes industry should be paying a lot of homage to that original show. But yeah, in answer to your question, having spent 5 years in the Fly Music West End show, I got the opportunity to really feel from audiences what they love about the music, what they love about the show, and things that I would personally do differently. So I think what we've tried to do with our Rat Pack show, and audiences seem to be very responsive to it, is that we are very authentic to the original guys, but don't put old jokes in from the 1960s that don't translate to a 21st century audience. So it's kind of like, you could definitely see the characters, you could definitely see the character development, the attention to detail, the boys' voices are incredible. But then at the same time, it's possibly a little bit funnier than the original, because we're not that concerned about making sure that every single one of the jokes in the show is what was originally said in 1966.
Exactly. Because I think kind of humour doesn't translate to modern performers. Now, I'll use a comparison, which has nothing to do with Dino at all, but the Carry On films, for example. If you make a Carry On film now, it would be panned because of the kind of jokes. When you watch a Carry On film, it's still funny, dare I say it, because you know it's of a time, and the performers were of a time. So I think really kind of what you're doing has to be a modern version of. But why do you think it's important that there are tribute acts? Why is it important that people like you and other performers go out on stage every month, every Christmas, and be Dean Martin?
I'll tell you why it's important, because that is one of the golden ages in modern music, and it should never be forgotten. There is something quite incredible about that period of time and the music that was created in that time. And what's really interesting to me is when you find younger people, I say younger people, people in their 20s. I'll give you an example. I have a girl that works for me called Holly, who's 26. She joined me 3 years ago. She'd never heard a Rat Pack song. Yeah. And in the development of our show and being around it, she absolutely loves it. And it's a new generation that's being introduced to, for want of a better phrase, the golden age of music. And so if all of that stopped and then all you had on the radio now and all you could go and see was modern tributes and modern music, we'd be losing a part of our musical heritage.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's fascinating to kind of hear you say about, you know, when you started, you weren't a fan, weren't aware of Dean, Holly wasn't either. So what is it about the music, when you say it's the golden era, the golden age of music, what is it about that style you think that appeals to such a huge generation now, from people in their 20s to people older than us?
That's a really good question. I think that the music is timeless, and I think that it lends itself to the human experience. You know, if you listen to some of the lyrics of Frank Sinatra's songs, for example, if you listen to some of the lyrics of Dean's songs, they are truly about the human experience. They're about love, they're about family, they're about the heart, the soul. And if you compare that to some of the lyrics in modern music, I think you'll find na na na, hey hey, give it to me, as opposed to some of the, as opposed to some of the music, and that's why it shouldn't be forgotten. It was the craftsmanship of musical writing, the melody, the lyric, the ability to transport you to another place is very different to modern boppy music that you could listen to for 4 hours straight on the radio and not remember one note from.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree, because music today, sound like a couple of old farts, but music today is really disposable.
Yeah.
You can take it or leave it. I mean, I very rarely, if ever, listen to the radio.
Yeah, me too.
I don't listen to Radio 2 anymore because that's too modern for me. Of all channels, Radio 2 is too modern for me now, which shows how, again, time is progressing.
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe I might put buy the Pink album or Madonna because that's what I used to watch or listen and go and see when I was younger. So I suppose that's that kind of legacy of those kind of artists for me is kind of stuck. But with Dean, obviously growing up with Dean and him knowing my dad and what we've done since 1960s, the DMA, it's part of my kind of makeup, I suppose. And it becomes part of us. Well, I mean, yourself, 20 years, you know, you're managing shows now, 20 years later, Holly's kind of doing them with you. And it becomes part of who we are. We sing songs, you know, hum his songs to ourselves, if we can sing or not. And I think it's kind of, as you say, it has to be part of today's culture, because if it's lost, it's lost forever. And it's up to people like you that really keep this going. And for all of the Dean Martin fans out there, thank you for keep doing this.
Thank you. You know, it's an honor to be associated with these guys. It's an honor to be associated with this music. And I just think that another thing about the music that's so special, perhaps for some people, is that they grew up with their parents playing records and playing music. And perhaps, especially, I believe Christmas isn't Christmas without the Rat Pack, right?
Absolutely.
You know, I think back to my childhood, and my dad would have been sitting at the kitchen table with a book working, and he would have had Dean Martin in the background, all of the Christmas classics. Mm-hmm. And although I didn't sit down and appreciate them completely as a child, the music still went in. It still went in. And so, as I say, I didn't really know Dean Martin when I looked at it at 28. Mm. When I finally delved into the music and remembered that my parents listened to that when I was a kid, it kind of, the memories kind of flooded back. And I feel like this music is so synonymous with moments in time and moments in your life. And Christmas especially is one of those.
Yeah, absolutely. There was something I was kind of reading, actually was watching the other day. It was an interview with Harrison Ford about Indiana Jones 5. And the interviewer said to him, and as is known, Harrison can be quite a grumpy interviewee, but he seems to have mellowed in his 80 years now. And this interviewer said to him, I don't know if you've heard this before, but, you know, all the films you've made, all the pleasure you've given to people in their dark moments, you know, whether we're having trouble at school or at home or family, whatever it will be, you've always been there to make people happy. And he seemed genuinely surprised or acknowledged what this interview was saying to him. And I kind of thought about that. And I thought that's kind of what people like Dean does and Frank does.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Kind of whether you watch his films or listen to his music, there's something about him as a character, as an individual, that makes you forget your problems, forget your troubles. And I think that's probably why a lot of people do kind of veer towards that era of music, certainly kind of coming to see your shows as well, because it does take them away from the modern world.
Exactly that. To a time that, dare I say it, was better. You know, you always look back with rose-tinted glasses. I know that. But, you know, people of a certain age like us, I think we'd look back on those moments and think, God, wouldn't it have been incredible to see these guys live, to be a part of that moment of history?
Yeah, you know? Absolutely. And you know, I never saw Frank or Sammy live, but we were fortunate enough to see Dean when he came over in 83 and 87 to the UK. And it was just watching him on, watching him live on a on film and listen to his records is nothing like watching him live on stage. It's quite an unexplainable kind of feeling.
Absolutely. That
when he walks, when you see him physically walk on the stage, you simply cannot forget him. And incredible. It's just his mannerisms, his voice inflection, the way he interacts with the audience. And people do kind of think, even now, that he was just a guy that came on stage, sang a few songs, forgot a few of the lines, forgot where his mic was, and wandered off again. But he was so much more than that.
He was a craftsman.
So when you kind of, when you embodied him, is that right word for me to use, when you embodied him?
I guess so. Yeah, it's as good a word as any.
How close did you feel you were getting to a caricature without being a caricature?
Oh, that's a good question. The intention is always to not become a caricature, you know. And from a performer's perspective, you know, I know you've spoken to other guys that do this, some great guys that do this far better than me. But everybody, when they first start doing a tribute to someone, they do too much, you know. When they get on stage, they know that Dean Martin touches his face. They know that Dean Martin has a hand movement. They know that, and they get so nervous that they feel they've got to keep doing these movements. So all of a sudden, they end up looking like they've got Tourette's. Something going on. You know, it's like, breathe, relax.
Yeah.
The idea for me is to attain as much information about the mannerisms, attain as much information about his sound, his delivery, his relationship with the audience, and then put it to the back of my mind. Because I want anything that does come out to be authentic and real and happening in the moment, rather than thinking, I haven't done a mannerism for 5 seconds, I better touch my face, I better swing a hand, I better kick my leg, you know? But that comes with practice and time in front of an audience. So the answer is, at the beginning, most definitely I was a caricature, and it's awful and embarrassing to think about, because it doesn't do the great Dean Martin justice. But over years and time and experience, you feel like you kind of settle into his energy and focus on giving the audience a great time rather than worrying about mannerisms, you know?
Indeed.
Does that make sense?
It makes sense. But dare I say it, Dean himself was a caricature of himself in his late.
Yeah.
You know, he really forced the whole apple juice in your glass there. Always in character. I think even in his later years, he absolutely was a caricature of his drunk persona, which we all know he wasn't. And I think it's kind of, I think that's a shame. I think that's why a lot of people still think now that he was just a drunk guy, because he wanted to push that. And we've spoken before on previous podcasts with other guests, and we all kind of came to the point that we got frustrated with him. Even now, watching him frustrated on the Johnny Carson, 80s Johnny Carson interviews, thinking, why are you being like that? Just be yourself. And I think it's a shame he didn't do himself any favours. And I think Jeannie, his wife, even said to him, when are you going to stop doing this, Dean? You know, it's enough's enough now. Yeah. And I think he got to a point where he didn't know how else to be, because that's what people expected of him.
Exactly.
When you kind of saw him on stage in Cabaret, he was not the man who was interviewed on a talk show.
Yeah. It's yeah, absolutely. And then if you really want to start digging into that, you know, he was a very private man. He didn't really speak to even his closest friends about how he really felt. So
yeah.
How much did he bottle up over the years? How much did he, was he dealing with mentally? And we live in a time where mental health is at the forefront of everything. Back then, men were supposed to be men and not talk about their feelings. And I wonder how, you know, for people like us, it's really sad to watch later Dean, because as you say, you just want him to be himself. And he's so wrapped up in wanting to give the audience this caricature, which they think he is. And I wonder how much of that comes from pain. I wonder how much of that comes from, you know, mental capacity. You know, he had so much going on in his life that he screwed up relationships because he wasn't willing to talk about his feelings. And even Jeannie always said, you know, she never really knew him. None of his friends ever really knew him.
So, absolutely. And, you know, even the kind of the few times in his later years when, and not actually early on, when Dad started kind of dealing with, talking with him and working with him, and he sent over a box of LPs. I think he sent over Dino Latino, like 500 Dino Latinos that suddenly turned up on Dad's doorstep one day in 1962. And Dean called him, and Dad called him and said, "Thank you for sending these LPs." And he said to my dad, "Don't ever thank me ever again, ever." And it was like, okay. And my dad was saying that was he didn't quite know. Did he offend him?
Yeah.
Was he offended? Did he upset him? Was this the end of this very brief kind of episode, as the song goes? But ton of dad got to know that's what Dean was like. He didn't want to be thanked.
Mm.
He did it because he wanted to do it, not because he felt he had to. If he was going to send my dad so many LPs or U-matics of his shows, because he wanted to, not because he had to. And we were kind of very, dad was very aware of that. And we were very aware of that even now. But Dean never needed us, not really.
Yeah.
And we always kind of wonder, I wish I kind of asked my dad this before he passed on, why did he think Dean was so supportive of the DMA when he had no need to be?
Yeah. You know? I guess just appreciative that someone, you know, really appreciated what he did and wanted to spread the word, I guess.
Yeah, I suppose so. And I that's kind of why it kind of comes down to you guys now to keep that word going. And without you, as I say, it would just die a death. He would just become another, all these artists would just become another old singers of the 40s, 50s. Yeah. Nobody cares about. Exactly. So you do more than just Dean, don't you? You don't stick to Dean on Veritas. You do other acts as well, don't you? Other performances.
We do. Yeah, we have a series of shows in theatres this year. We have a tribute to the Temptations, which is coming into theatres in September. Mm-hmm. Which is really exciting. It's going to be a fabulous show. We've got our Disco Inferno show, which is rolling around theatres. I mean, that's just so much fun. It's so tongue-in-cheek. Can't take yourself seriously when you're running around singing disco stuff. and the amazing thing about that show is, you know, it spans such a big age group. People come in groups from like mid-20s up to their 60s, all dressed up, and they're up dancing from the second number. And we've got our fantastic Four Seasons show, Walk Like a Man. Because I actually performed in the West End show Jersey Boys. When I was back in my performing days. So it was a pleasure to put that show together. And that's been one of our most successful shows. Got a Dusty Springfield show, which goes down really well.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're always on the lookout for and making new things. So. Yeah. It's an exciting time for Veritas now, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, you're going to the West End with a Rat Pack.
Yes, yes. After all this time, we finally have our first West End date. We've got Christmas with the Rat Pack on December the 5th at the Adelphi in London. And tickets go on sale this Friday. So very exciting for us.
Yeah. And where can we buy tickets from?
They can buy tickets from the Adelphi website, and they can also buy the tickets from TEG Live. I'll send you the link.
Yeah, I'll put it on now on the post. Absolutely.
That'd be great.
Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. So kind of going back to to you directing the Rat, and I guess you direct the Rat Pack shows now, don't you?
Yes.
As well as producer. Yeah. Are you a hard taskmaster in getting Dean right? Have you got such a passion for Dean that you're willing to say off?
I'm a nightmare. You know, I'm a nightmare for the guys. It's really unfair because, you know, I know Frank's and I know Sammy's and I go, right, okay, yeah, that's good for me. Dean, no, let's do it again. No, you've got to do this. You've got to do that. Let's do it again. Let's do it again. Let's do it again. So, you know, they end up being good at what they do, but they're like, why do I have to do all this extra work? And those guys are fine. So, yeah, hard taskmaster. But
do you think as well, though, because... yes, because you're kind of close to the role, but when you watch Sammy and Frank, likewise with Dean, they all have their own characters and characterizations and ways they move. But I think when you watch Sammy and Frank, you can see who they are.
Yeah, but
with Dean, he's got so many layers to him. He's more subtle.
Absolutely, yeah. And as you mentioned earlier on, if you're not careful, it can just come across as a lack of care and a caricature, and that is something that I will not abide. You know, you can't just. And also, directing the show is really hard because, you know, you've got to let people, actors, be themselves and deliver how they see it. And it's really hard. You just want to step on every line and say it like this, say it like that, say it like this. Move your hand there, do that. And that's what makes it harder, because everybody's going to deliver it and anticipate it in their own way.
So with that in mind, do you welcome your actors bringing their own personality into the role of Dean, Frank and Sammy, or are you still quite strict they have to be as you would expect the audience to see Dean, Frank and Sammy?
I welcome people's research into the character.
Yeah.
So if interesting thing about two actors is you can watch the same footage. If I send a package of footage to an actor and say, dig through all of this YouTube material, look at all of this material, get it into your bones, they will see different things about Dean that I do. And so when we get into the rehearsal studio, if they've done their homework, I'm open to a conversation of why a delivery might be like that instead of how I would like to see it.
Yeah.
But inevitably it ends up being my way.
Yeah. Yeah. Of course, Frank Sinatra.
Yeah.
So for example, like with Dusty, your Dusty shows, how do you make sure that the actress being Dusty is Dusty and not the actress being Dusty?
Again, it's down to the research.
Yeah.
You know, it's down to the research. If we agree on the research material, so the Dusty Springfield that we're going to portray on stage is the Dusty Springfield from this time period. Therefore, I want you to do your research on this time period. Who was she friends with? Martha and the Vandellas. Martha was her best friend. How did she present herself at this point in time? What were her vocal qualities at this point in time? How did she talk to the audience at this point in time?
Yeah.
So if we agree all of that, then there's enough common ground there to put together something which should always be a hybrid of authenticity with an actor's ability to entertain an audience.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I think as well, you got kind of talking about kind of eras that you set the shows in. I think that's kind of really important, because even though people who come and see your shows, I guess, aren't dedicated hardcore Dusty fans to some extent, they just like the era, like the music. But obviously, you do get hardcores that are going to be from the audience. But I think if you suddenly dropped in into a 60s show, a Pet Shop Boys number with Dusty, it just would be so...
Exactly.
Wrong, just like dropping in something from Dean's last album in the middle of a 60s Sans Rat Pack recreation.
Exactly.
Even though it's a Dean Martin song, it wouldn't work. Do you ever see, I'm guessing you probably don't, because the actors that you choose are of a certain age bracket to fulfill the criteria you're looking for, but do you ever want to do an older Dean show, an older Frank and Sammy show that caters their more 70s and 80s music? Or would that be too out of people's knowledge and remembrance of who they are?
Okay, so there's two answers to that question. Firstly, while you're absolutely right, you wouldn't drop a Pet Shop Boys version of a Dusty Springfield song into a show, because that would be too much of a stretch of the imagination. But there is a level of creative license within the process, within the creative process of putting something together. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't ignore one of Frank Sinatra's most well-known and biggest hits because it happened in the 80s if it was a Rat Pack show. If it was a Rat Pack at the Sands in 1966, then you've actually made yourself a very narrow window of material that you can use.
Yeah.
But people are coming to be entertained, not to be told, this is all of the music that happened in 66, so you can't hear anything else. Same as with our Temptations show. There are 24 guys that have worn the Temptations jackets over the last 40 years. And the Temptations, original Temptations, still exists with one original member in it.
Yeah.
But what our show is the concert that never was. So it's the original five guys spanning the entire musical career as it would have been sung by the original five guys. So there's a good example of creative license, being able to take advantage of this incredible body of work over a period of decades, but still being able to deliver it at the time when people remember these guys at their best.
Yeah.
So My Way wasn't written in the 60s, you know, or True. Gentle on My Mind, all of those great songs. Hmm. You couldn't do a Rat Pack show without those songs.
Yeah.
But I think that there's enough creative license in the process that people are coming to the theatre to see their idols in their heyday deliver the best of that artist's music from their career. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. It makes perfect sense.
I love the idea that people can get swept away and lost in the moment and feel like they're in the presence of the original because the guys are doing such a good job on stage.
Yeah.
And also, let's not forget the people working behind the stage as well. You know, you need great sound, you need great musicians, you need good lighting, which is going to evoke this moment that people are going to get swept away with. So not only do you have a great performer, but you've got a great creative team on and off stage that are going to make this moment and give people the opportunity to get swept away and forget for a moment that they might not be watching the original. I mean, that's the dream. If you can give people that moment, that's wonderful.
So I'm going to ask you as well, when I came to see you, which would have been 2 years ago, probably, which is far too long ago, you ended a Rat Pack show with Viva Las Vegas.
Yes. Yeah.
Do you mind if I ask why? Because it was
just for love.
And just for love. I've got to say, because obviously knowing Dean's act, knowing the Rat Pack for so many years and studying it immensely and with an inch of its life kind of thing. And what I liked about your version of the Rat Pack shows is you mix it up.
Yeah.
You don't always have Dean on first, then Sammy, then Frank. You may put Sammy on first and then Frank on second. And I like the fact that you play with not necessarily the audience expectations, because the audience may not be conscious of that as much.
Yeah.
I like the way that you do move that around a bit. And then when you suddenly dropped in Viva Las Vegas, I think this is just fantastic. It's like the Rat Pack singing Elvis song. And I thought it shouldn't have worked. It shouldn't have worked.
Absolutely.
But it did. And it had the audience standing.
Exactly.
And of all the song the audience was standing up to was the one that wasn't a Rat Pack song, which I thought was quite ironic.
It's funny, isn't it? It's funny. Yeah. You know, we get our Frank Sinatra is Tom Russell Fox, who is, in my opinion, one of the two greatest Sinatra tributes in the business. He's fantastic. Yeah. His version of My Way always gets the audience to the point where they want to get on their feet. And then right after that, you stick in Viva Las Vegas and the boys are having a ball on stage. Everyone's having a ball in the audience. And as you say, it's completely unexpected and everybody absolutely adores it. You know, we still do that I'm not quite sure where it came from originally. We just thought, let's have some fun.
Yeah.
And the guys say, we're going to do one for you. We don't normally do this, but this is one we borrowed from a friend. And then we crack into that.
Yeah.
But yeah, yeah, you know.
Do you want me to put this, keep this bit in the podcast, or do you want to keep it out so it's a surprise for people just before we go on?
Yeah, let's take it out.
Case.
Let's take it out.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I won't mention it in the podcast. That's fine. Absolutely. Okay. So, kind of what then, as a producer director, what do you still want to do with Veritas for yourself?
I want to send people away having had a great time. Look, it's not Shakespeare. It's about giving the audience the best possible night you can. And if there's a little twist in there that they weren't expecting, if there's a little something that makes them go, oh, that was fun. Well, that was different.
Yeah.
That's great. You know, that's wonderful. I will never get bogged down in the creative process of we've got to be different. We've got to do something that the audience aren't expecting all the time, because that's not what the people are coming to see. That's not what they're paying their money for. They want to come. They want to experience the music delivered very well. They want to be taken on a journey. That's, you know, that's our main thing. I'm not trying to change the wheel. I'm trying to make the journey as smooth as possible.
Yeah. That being said, though, what can people expect from the Rat Pack Christmas show this year?
The show this year. Mm-hmm. We're going to have some fun. We're all really excited about it. We're so excited because it's going to be a bigger production that we've done in a while. There's going to be a bigger band on stage. Yeah. We have three fantastic performers for the show. You're going to see a couple of backing vocalists coming in to give a little bit of extra something, maybe give Dean something to look at. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's going to be a really fun homage to Rat Pack at Christmas, the Veritas way. You know,
absolutely.
We've been doing this for a long time. We're really excited that we get to do it in London. And if it sells well, we hope we're going to be doing a lot more dates in London in the future.
And would you look to go outside the UK?
Yeah, absolutely. We were recently asked to do a few cruises and things like that, which we're not going to do because the timing's not right. We are looking to do some dates in Dubai with our good friend Lucy McGee over there. She wants the boys to come over and perform some theatres over there. You know, the world's our lobster, really. The thing is now that the West End show is announced, we are on a mission to do a big sort of UK tour next Christmas. So Christmas 2024, we want to be in every city in the UK, bringing everybody some Christmas spirits.
Absolutely, as it should be. And the best way to do it is with a Rat Pack.
Exactly.
She gets too hungry for dinner at 8. It's California. It's cold and it's damp. That's why the lady is a tramp.
A Swingin' Christmas at the Sands, the 5th of December 2023, the Adelphi, London, UK. Book your tickets now. Links in description.
You've been listening to the DMA Podcast, a Shaken Not Stirred and Memory Hive production for the Dean Martin Association. The DMA Podcast is copyright Memory Hive Productions and is a not-for-profit project. There are no financial incentives or fees payable to any contributor, guest, or performer.
Click on our logo to subscribe to the Dean Martin Association's official YouTube channel. please also visit DeanMartinAssociation.com. Why not also subscribe to our podcast on Spotify? Search the Dean Martin Association podcast.